unfortunately, that this is on a Friday because we have a really special event today. We have Mehrangiz Kar from Iran. Iran, of course, is in the news all the time at the moment. Mostly people are focusing on the nuclear program of Iran at the moment. But we've, of course, also been interested in developments of democracy and the human rights situation in Iran. And we're lucky to have one of the most prominent experts and activists at the same time dealing with both of these issues with us. Mihrangīz Kar is a human rights lawyer. She's a writer. She's an essayist. And I learned a former editor of a now banned literary review in Iran. She was born in a city in the south of Iran, Ahvaz. She attended the College of Law in Tehran at the university, then was employed at the Institute of Social Security, and also wrote for the press and published over 100 articles, both on social issues and on political issues. In 2000, she attended a conference in Berlin, Germany, that became famous afterwards, that brought together reformist Iranian activists. When she returned from Berlin to Iran, she was sentenced to to prison for 4 years, first for speaking out against the government in Iran. That sentence was later reduced to 6 months. However, her husband is still a prisoner back in Iran. She's been in the United States now for 3 years, would like to go back, in fact, cannot go back at the moment because she would face more persecution there. And one reason for that, of course, is that she's not silent and still won't be silent and still speaks out against the things in Iran that that she thinks have to change. And that's what she will be doing today as well. Mihrangīz Kar will speak to us about obstacles to democracy under the Iranian constitution, which is also the project that she's doing research on at the moment as a fellow at Radcliffe College. We're very fortunate to have her here, and please welcome with me Mihrangīz Kar.
Thank you very much for coming, and I appreciate of law school for having me. I like to talk about obstacles of the constitution for democracy and human rights in Iran. As you know, now all Western countries, they are focused on Iran because of something else, but I think most problem in Iran, especially for political activists, human rights activists, and women's rights activists who are working for changes is the situation of human rights. And that's why we are working so hard to give more knowledge to your community and other community about our human rights situation in Iran. Unfortunately, my English is not perfect, and I hope we could have conversation after I read something about obstacles of democracy in our legal institutions and legal structure. At present, the Constitution of the Islamic Republic of Iran is being debated from two different points of views. One point insists that the Constitution should honor the central principle of freedom and that the legitimacy of political power should be determined by the free will of people and society. The other viewpoint, which upholds the current framework within which the Constitution falls with the legitimacy of political power in unfaltering loyalty for certain groups and individuals considered to be the manifestation of divine will and personification of Islamic principles. For those who support this latter view, the term republic does not in any way invalidate the term Islamic, and the people's participation in political matters is delineated solely by the tolerance level of the fuqaha, Islamic jurists. In the years following the 1997, which marked the beginning of the Islahat reform period, these opposing points of view have clashed on a daily basis. As a result of these observable conflicts, the contradictions that exist within the Constitution have grown more and more lucid and comprehensible even to the common man. By contradictions in the Constitution, one refers to the elements within the Constitution that are at odds with both the principles of democracy and those of human rights. Inconsistencies between the Constitution and the democratic principles are clearly visible in areas pertaining to the parliament, the judicial branch, presidential power, oversight on the actions of the supreme leader, people rights, and elections, all elections, presidential elections, parliament elections, and others. I choose some part of that to talk about that because I don't have enough time for all of them. Parliament. According to the Constitution, Article 72, the Islamic Parliament enacts the country's laws. However, a council called the Shura-i-Negahban or Guardian Council possesses an authority that can supersede the principles of parliamentary independence. The Guardian Council's power interferes with and vexes Parliament's influence in two areas: lawmaking and determining the competency of Parliament members. The Guardian Council consists of six faqih or Islamic jurists, all of whom are personally appointed by the supreme leader, and six Islamic legal experts who are indirectly chosen by the subsections of the office of the supreme leader, Article 91. The Guardian Council's interferes in the area of lawmaking. Laws ratified by Parliament are not binding until approved by the Guardian Council. The Council's duty, is preside over every law passed by Parliament and ensure that it is not inconsistent with the Islamic rules, a duty determined by a majority vote by the fuqaha or Islamic jurists. The Council also makes certain that any ratified law is not inconsistent with the Constitution itself, as determined by a majority vote of all 12 Council members, Article 96. Therefore, Parliament does not possess true legal legitimacy without the Guardian Council, Article 93. Not surprisingly, this has restrained parliamentary representatives from implementing laws based on the Iranian people's demands for democracy and accepted societal practices. Additionally, it allows the appointed Islamic jurists to resist those laws passed by Parliament supporting human rights, democracy, and women's rights by utilizing the Council's full power to veto. In the first years following the adoption of the constitution in 1979, after Islamic Revolution, Ayatollah Khomeini decided that a device was needed to overcome any impasse that might arise between the Majlis, Parliament, and the Guardian Council. He therefore decreed into existence a separate body, one effectively appointed by the Supreme Leader, to handle this problem. The exact translation of its name is a bit difficult. In full, it is something like board to make decisions on the basis of the interests of the Islamic public, of the Islamic Republic of Iran, or for short, the Expediency Council. Expediency in this case means the interests of the Islamic Republic, the regime. There is no reference to the public. This body, which was formally added to the Constitution in 1990, is the final arbiter in contemporary Iranian politics when there is no agreement between the Parliament and Guardian Council on a particular law. It goes to the Expediency Council, which has the final word. Before the election of the reformist-dominated Sixth Parliament in 2000, the Expediency Council had sometimes permitted the final passage of laws that the Guardian Council had rejected as contradictory to Islam. At the time, the Expediency Council was more interested in solving problems than in setting to it that legislation was indeed compatible with Islamic law. During the Sixth Majlis, this Majlis was organized in 2000, and majority of them was reformist. During the Sixth Majlis, however, both supervising bodies, the Guardian Council and the Expediency Council, had been completely dominated by conservative anti-reformist elements, leaving the reformist majority in the Majlis Parliament totally blacked. There are a number of bills that had gone from the Parliament to the Guardian Council, which the Guardian Council had either rejected or left undecided, and even where bills had reached the Expediency Council, the latter had so far refused to make any decision on them. Included among these acts were a proposal law that would reduce restrictions on foreign investment in Iran, a very important issue for the Iranian economy, as well as one on women's rights. The Guardian Council's interference in determining the competency of Parliament members. The Guardian Council oversees all types of elections and referendum, Article 99, and is responsible for the interpretation of the Constitution, Article 98. The Council devised an interpretation of the term Nizarat or supervision from Article 99, of the Constitution, which led to the ratification of a 1995 law concerning parliamentary elections. According to this interpretation, the Council's supervision of the elections is approbational, signifying that with its influence, the Council can reject the competency of any candidate whose political ideology it does not support. The most recent case of such approbation in action was during recent election for the 7th Parliament last February, during which a widespread rejection of many candidacy applicants was witnessed. Therefore, as long as the Guardian Council plays the role of political watchdog, the parliamentary elections in Iran cannot be deemed free elections, one of the elementary principles of democracy. In the type of election process taking place in Iran, not only do secular candidates not have the slightest chance of entering the parliament, but even those who display outright support for the Islamic Republic and its form of religious government but happen to hold divergent political attitudes disapproved by the Guardian Council cannot navigate such impasses. The judicial branch, a key principle of democracy that must be included in any democratic constitution, is the principle of judiciary independence. The constitution of the Islamic Republic of Iran circumvents this principle in the following ways. The supreme leader appoints one fair-minded mujtahid or clergyman who is well-versed in judicial matters as the head of the government's judicial branch, the highest position in the branch, for a period of 5 years, Article 157. Employing fair-minded and capable judges, appointing and dismissing them, changing the locations where they serve, determining their ranks and giving them promotions, etc., are all among the duties and powers of the head of the judicial branch, Article 158. However, an independent judicial branch cannot be achieved if the most high-ranking figure in the judiciary is appointed by highest-ranking political figure in the country. Naturally, in the current situation, the head of the judicial branch in Iran follows the particular political ideology that has elevated him to that position. In other words, the political ideology of the supreme leader. Powers of the president. There is not balance between the responsibilities and authority of the president in Iran. When the victims of violations of constitutional right plead their case to the president, he is placed in a difficult situation as he lacks the necessary authority to take decisive action. In domestic policy, since the president does not have control over the Niruye-e-intizami or police force, he faced many obstacles when trying to expand political and other types of freedoms, Article 110. In foreign policy, he is not the chief decision maker regarding critical matters. Rather, the supreme leader has the final say on all policies, Article 110. Also, the president has the responsibility of defending the constitution. His powers are not technically determined or affirmed by the constitution itself. Thus, these powers are not guaranteed to be exercised. According to Section 10 of Article 10, he can even be tried for infringing on his legal duties. But as we know, he does not possibilities to do anything. The Islamic Republic public radio and television is completely outside the jurisdiction of the president and is a subdivision of the supreme leader's office, abiding solely by his command, Article 175. As such, the president is essentially deprived of this vital and effective mode of communication with the people. Rights of the people. The Iranian people are treated equally. Article 19 of Constitution. Despite this article, all Iranians are not treated equally because other articles in the Constitution qualify and enfeeble this one along with the principle and tenets of human rights which are contained within it. For instance, the Constitution grants certain rights to only three religious minorities, Zoroastrians, Jewish and Christians, while other religious minorities are denied even minimal basic human rights, Article 13. Immediately after stating that each and every individual enjoys all human, political, economical, social, and cultural rights, Article 20 of the Constitution introduces the condition that mawazin-e-Islam or Islamic standards must be followed. In another instance, where the Constitution calls upon the government to guarantee women's rights, the article also adds ba ra'ayat-e mawazin-e-Islam or with consideration to Islamic standards, Article 21. Taking into consideration the fact that these Islamic standards are not separately defined in specific terms anywhere in the Constitution or in other laws, it becomes implausible for all individuals to enjoy all human rights in such a context. Additionally, the Constitution defends the freedom of speech, the freedom to establish independent parties, civil and political organizations, and the freedom to organize rallies and demonstrations. However, all of these freedoms are contingent upon this same observation of Islamic standard, Articles 24, 26, and 27. The word freedom is mentioned in all three articles, but this term loses its effectiveness when appended with Islamic standards, leaving it up to the subjective judgments of ruling officials to define Islamic standards and interpret the articles as they wish. Therefore, in the area of people's rights, the Constitution cannot be considered the protector and guardian of freedom. Supervision of the Supreme Leader's actions. The highest ranking position in Iran is held by the Supreme Leader. Appointing the Supreme Leader is the responsibility of the Majlis-e-Khobregan, elite majlis, or the Experts Council, whose members are elected, Article 107 and 110. In Iran, the three branches of government are the judicial branch, the executive branch, and the legislative branch, which are all under the supervision of the Velayat-e Mutlaqe Amr va Imamat-e Ummat, or the absolute authority on all matters and the religious leader of the nation, etc., the Supreme Leader, Article 57. This absolute authority does not grant the Iranian people the opportunity to oversee his actions. However, the Constitution confers the responsibility of supervising the Supreme Leader's actions to the Experts Council. Here, a fundamental paradox reveals itself, as the Experts Council is not elected by the people and has not earned the right to perform the task of supervision. The competency of each member of the expert council must be approved by the six Islamic jurists of the Guardian Council. If they are not approved, they are ultimately disqualified from becoming candidates. In addition, the six Islamic jurists of the Guardian Council are themselves chosen by the supreme leader, yet Article 111 of the Constitution calls upon the experts' council to oversee the actions of the supreme leader. The question becomes evident. How is it possible for the expert council, itself approved by the Guardian Council, to oversee the actions of the supreme leader? After the 1997, as you know, it's marked the Islahat period, reform period, when the dialogue on reform became more widespread, the vast differences in attitude between the two factions of the government began to cause turmoil. It can be said that many clashes originated from the shortcomings and obstacles built into the framework of the Constitution of the Islamic Republic of Iran. The arguments circled around topics like the desire for a more independent parliament, the issue pertaining to the president's power, the rights of the people, supervision of the supreme leader's action, the lack of an independent judiciary, and the lack of judicial impartiality in journalistic and political cases, the lack of free elections. For this reason, the Constitution was scrutinized in a comprehensive theoretical and practical probe executed by legal experts in the country. And now the legal experts in the country, now they are continuing that, and they say, according to this legal system, we cannot get democracy and human rights and respect to women's rights. The pursuit of a resolution to these issues led to a referendum proposal, which still remains an open topic of discussion on this way. But anyway, there is no legal flexibility to make the necessary changes in the structure of the Constitution that would attract and facilitate true democracy. Major transformations in the Constitution are not possible through peaceful means. Therefore, any type of constitutional change will also lead to a change in regime. There is in our constitution some word like referendum, but this referendum is very limited in this legal system, because in this constitution they order and they say that nobody can change the Islamic fundamental of this constitution. So something that we do have in our constitution about referendum is not working at the moment. And that's why now we can say there is a big crisis, big political crisis for getting good resolution, peacefully resolution, and this is our problem, because it's really difficult, and the regime is not tolerate to give permission to have demonstration, to have a free press, to have to have freedom of expression, and something like that. And that's why now many political activists in Iran, many human rights activists in Iran, they are under pressure. A big part of them, they were imprisoned, and now they are free. They are released on big bail, and some part of activists, they are banned from leaving the country, and all of them now under pressure, but they are working sometimes, and they are talking about their situation, and now we are hopeful community of American academic people or European Union, they talk about this situation in Iran more than talking about something that is very political. Thank you very much. And now I'm ready if you have some question. Thank you. Thanks so much. Thank you.
You want to take questions or shall I take questions?
You can do that. Okay.
I was just wondering if do you think it's going to get worse before it gets better?
Getting worse before what? Before what date?
Before any change. Do you think it's got to get, sort of the human rights crisis has to get even worse before you have enough reform, or enough people that will pressure reform into happening, if that's possible?
You mean before reform, you mean? Yeah. I think something is getting better, but it doesn't mean that now it's similar. You know, before reform, we couldn't criticize the government. We couldn't talk and write about something that was happening in revolutionary courts or some political activists who were under pressure or under torture in revolutionary courts, especially revolutionary courts. We couldn't talk about limitation of Velayat-e-Faqih, supreme leader. But after reform, everybody who were active in, especially in newspapers, because as you know, after reform, we could have many reformist newspapers. And because some ministry that was directing on that, they were related with reformist government, they could help them. And sometimes that judiciary system stopped one newspaper, immediately they were giving license for very new newspaper. And this was a very good policy. And that's why we cannot say everything now is stopped in Iran for talking and writing. So we can say, basically, it's better than before reform. But now, after a seventh election for parliament, that was last February, because in this election, Guardian Council rejected all reformist candidates. Now this parliament has a majority of not just conservatives, but I think fundamentalists and very extremist people now they are in this parliament. So they are working and they want to stop everything in Iran. And now they can say that because our national interests are in danger by United States, by European Union, or something like that, they can do worse than before. Just I can say, after reform, they try their best doing everything against human rights and political activists according law, and because this legal system is not good and has not capacity for democracy and freedom, so they can work and they say everything that we are doing is according law, and we respect rule of law. And now this is our problem, because they say everything that we are working on that against political activists, against human rights activists, against women's rights activists, all of them are according law. And I think sometimes they are true, because we need a big change in our legal system before we can say we are free to talk, we are free to write, we are free to organize independent political system or something else. So we need a big change in our constitution.
Do you feel that, Iran's relationship or economic relationship with Russia and China is like an impediment to Western influence with respect to human rights? And then also, as a follow-up to that, would you feel that the human rights activists in Iran are, interested in the war in Iraq or ambivalent to it, or, is it something that might potentially help their interests or actually hurt them?
I think all political activists, and human rights activists, and women's rights, all the people now who are active, even at this time inside Iran, and they are under pressure, they don't like something like that, like a military attack. But unfortunately, I have to explain for you, because people in Iran, they are very tired. And they are very unhappy with this system, with this political system. If you go inside Iran, you can hear something from very, very, very regular people. They say, oh, when they come, they will attack to them. But I think it would be change if they do that. And after the first attack, they will change their mind. Now they are very tired. Now they are very angry. And something that is really problematic in Iran is Iranian people, because they have passed revolution and reform. Now they do have a lot of experiences about revolution and about something. And they don't like to pay for that. They don't like to pay for changes. And they like somebody else come and change and then leave the country. But I think they are not ready. They are not ready for that in practice. Just now they are angry. And that's why somebody who goes to Iran and give some report, unfortunately, there is a lot of thing like that, something that the people, they are talking about that, and sometimes they are saying, oh, we are happy why they don't come pretty soon. But I think it means Iranian people demand a big change, but not they want at the military attack. I think if American government, State Department, and the European Union, they want to translate this situation, they can understand that Iranian people, they want change, but they don't want pay for that by military's attack.
Has the reform had any impact on the role of Baha'is and other religious minorities as of
now? Yeah, I think I explained just three minorities. They do have some rights, and we can say now they are insecure, but even they were in trouble first decade of revolution, of Islamic revolution. All of them were in dangerous, and everything were like Bashgah Aramane, club of some clubs that they were organizing that for a long time, for I think 100 years before Islamic Revolution, they closed everything. But now their situation is better than before. But other minorities, they are in danger and they don't have security. If somebody kill them, they don't punish murder because they say they are murtad. I don't know what they, in English, what's that? Murtad is somebody, especially for Baha'i, is against Islam or somebody who was Muslim and then denied Islam. And they face them as somebody who their blood is not valid. And anybody kill them, they don't punish murder. And in other cases, they cannot, sometimes they cannot go to university and they reject them, like guardian counsel that in legislation or something else, they do that and they reject them and they are really in danger. And by this legal situation, I think we cannot talk about respect to human rights according to this legal system. They are in danger in all fields.
My understanding is that Iran is still, I mean, a lot of Iranians are still quite nationalistic and have some anti-American feelings. And my question is, are the forces that call for reform and democracy and human rights, are they generally viewed as being somewhat pro-America? And is, I mean, my question is, like, what's the interrelationship between the forces of nationalism and the forces of reform and democracy?
You know, I think now both of them. Because Iran has passed, I think, more than 100 years from Enqilab-e Mashrute, constitutional revolution. We had it in 1906. And it was for justice and it was for constitution because we didn't have constitution before 1906. And it was the first time that Iranian people, they demand for justice and participation in legislation or something like that. And after that, we had some reform before revolution during Shah. And now we pass Islamic Revolution since 1979. And then we had reform, 1997. And all slogan of people in these two periods, in revolution and reform, all the slogan were about democracy and human rights. And I think now Iranian people, if we want to separate regular people with elites and political activists, we can say that the people, they are pro-American. But at the first years of revolution, after revolution, all slogans for all regular people, it was against America, against, and I think if you follow the news of Iran, we had some against political persons in embassy of United States. And since that time, the relationship is ceased. And now Iranian people, they prefer to have normal relationships with United States. But I think they are not interested to change their political system by militarism attack. Political activists, if you are I think you are curious about them, how they feel. They feel they need to have normal relationships with United States. And sometimes they talk about that very clearly. And now if you read Iranian newspaper, you can find that. They want to have relationships with United States, but they have some demands. And they say if they want to have relationship with Iran, they have to talk in their negotiations about human rights situation in Iran, about justice in Iran. And now, not only human rights situation, but economic situation is getting worse in Iran. And we need some big changes even in that, because the people cannot be happy with one job, and sometimes they are working on three fields, one morning, one afternoon, one evening. And if they don't do that, they cannot afford their family. But I cannot say that they are not pro-American. They now, right now that we are talking, they are pro-American, but in long term, I think they are not angry with something like militarism attack. They need dialogue, they need talk, they need negotiation.
Yeah, you mentioned in the about the constitutional limitations on the president, but I wonder how much do the Iranian people blame President Khatami for not doing more to promote reform and for allowing the movement to kind of go back?
Most of them. Now, most of them. You know, the people knows he had not enough power for that. But they say, okay, you knew this legal system, you knew this constitution. Why you promised us something? Why you gave us some slogan? Because it was the reason that we voted to you twice, not once, twice. More than 20 million people voted to him. And now they say, why you didn't high risk? You didn't take high risk. We needed that because you had our support. Now President Khatami cannot be president again because he had 2-4 years process. And according our constitution, like United States constitution, he cannot be candidate again. But he has lost people, and this is terrible now. And this is our problem, because the people doesn't follow reformists anymore. And now they are working and they are thinking and they are looking for some solution for that. Because now, even now, they are active in Iran against conservative, against fundamentalists, but their hands are empty because the people is not following them. They don't support them. The people has very far distance from government, and they don't mind about conservative and reformist, both of them. And they are waiting for something that they so far they say we don't pay for that. We don't want another revolution. We don't have good experience of revolution. And that's why everything is very dark to predict the future. Just we can understand that the people doesn't support reformists because mistakes of Khatami.
I have a question on the constitution. Some of the problems seem to stem from the duality of attempts at democracy on the one hand and the supremacy of Islam on the other.
Yes.
Do you think first that it would be necessary to keep Islam out of the constitution in order to achieve true democracy, or are the two compatible? And secondly, if you thought so, would there be any likelihood that this could ever happen?
Yeah, at the beginning of reform, without we can get democracy according to this constitution, but by reform in Islamic standards. That's why we can say there is a movement, and by this movement, some clergy, some Islamic scholars, some writers, some speakers, all of them, they are working about new interpretation of Islam. And some of them, they say, we can get new interpretation of Islam according norms of human rights and women's rights and democracy. But unfortunately, after 8 years that we have passed that procedure, now all of political activists, they can understand that it's not easy. Because all of clergies who were giving us new interpretation of Islam, all of them were and are outside of political system, outside of Islamic government. And that's why they were not effective. They were not effective on legislation. They were not effective on political policy. And now they could get back everything, like parliament. And now they are getting back government, state from reformist people, because the next election, presidential election is, I think, June, and now we are looking to this, you know, to this scene, and we can see that conservative and fundamentalists, they are very active to have a president, conservative president, or more than this, a very fundamentalist president. So now we can understand that we need something. We are facing with very emergency problems, and for that we cannot wait for new interpretation of Islam, because if we want to wait for that, it takes time. Sometimes 50 years. Sometimes I don't know 100 years, because it's not something that we can get it immediately. We can understand that economic situation in Iran is getting worse. Human rights situation is getting worse. Women's rights situation is getting worse. And there are a lot of, not just political crises, even social crises in Iran. The rate of divorce is getting worse. The rate of criminal is getting worse. The rate of addiction is getting worse. So we cannot wait for that. I think, this is my personal opinion, I think before that, we need separation between Islam and the state. But I think reform in religion by new interpretation of Islam is very necessary, not for changing the government or something like that, but for changing the mind of some part of that population, some part of that population that they follow traditional clergies in Iran. And this is very dangerous, because anytime it's possible, they want to get power again, even after we can get separation between Islam and the state. So that's very important, and we respect this movement in Iran because we think we need that for future, for our future. And it could be support democracy, it could support human rights, support women's rights by new interpretation of Islam and by talking and writing about that. But unfortunately, even now, the clergy in Iran, the Islamic scholars in Iran, they don't have freedom of expression. So even this movement is stopping. So I think by this government and this legal system, even the clergies who want to give us new interpretation of Islam and they want to help us to get something better than this, sometimes they are in prison and sometimes they attack to them and they are afraid. And the first thing we need is freedom of expression. And if we can get it by support of international community, it's possible Iranian people say no to this political system. Majority of Iranian people who are silent now and who are not ready to pay for that and who don't like to have violence revolutionary again. That's why we think we have to say about our problems and we have to explain these obstacles that is in legal system and that obstacles that Iranian governor now, they make for political activists in Iran. And the first of them is freedom of expression, even for clergy.
He made several references to the memory of the revolution. Mm-hmm. And I'm really curious about how that affects the nature of activism in Iran now and the people who were the activists back then, before the revolution, before it got co-opted by Khomeini. Mm-hmm. They're still around. Can you say more about...
Just I can explain for you that before revolution, we had something in economic reform in family law for women, reform in penal code, because our penal code was not according Islam. It was not Islamic penal code. We had not stoning. We had not lashing. We had not... something like the age of maturity for women that is 9 years and something like that. We didn't have something like that. And our penal code was copying from Belgium and France. Social freedom, they accepted, that government accepted social freedom, just like to be enjoy with themselves, to hear music, to have fun. Yeah, by Shah. But there was not any chance to criticize political system. And to be opposition, there was not any chance. And that's why most important slogan of revolution was participation in political system for the people. That's why they were tired of torture by Savak or some newspaper. We did have a lot of newspaper, magazine. We had very good promotion in arts, in literature, in cinema, in everything. Just we didn't have any modernity touch with political system. And we didn't have permission to have independent political party or something like that. But after revolution, we lost social freedoms. And the people, a big part of people, they denied this Islamic system since at the beginning of revolution, because they could understand they don't have privacy, and it's possible government comes to their home, comes to their privacy and arrest them and something. But we cannot say that the result was nothing. I think the result of revolution is something like that, that now we are talking about that. Because anyway, it was inside Iran. It was hidden. And a part of the population of Iran, they were thinking like that. And since 1979, we could touch these people. And before that, we couldn't believe that. We couldn't believe that a big part of people, they want veil by force for women. We didn't really know that. We thought just they want to be free to have veil if they want. But we didn't know they want to have for other women by force, by lashing, by punishments, by violent punishments. And just I can say that future of Iran, it would be very democratic, but not in short term. I think we need pass some other process to get democracy, because now after 1979 and especially after 1997, the people could get better knowledge about democracy, about their society, and about something like a religious political system. And now, I think majority of people in Iran, who are Muslim, who they are Shia, they respect their religion. But they could understand by practice that they need separation between Islam and state. But it doesn't mean that they are denying Islam, because sometimes in abroad somebody says, a majority of people, they are against Islam, they are denying Islam because they are not happy with this political system. It's not true. And anybody who wants to study about Iran country, that this time they must respect their religion, because they respect their religion. Just I think they are ready to support of something that give them permission to say no to Islamic political system.
Take a short question.
Okay, real quick. In your work, it sounds like you personally do not appeal to an Islamic framework in making your arguments. What do you appeal to in speaking out against human rights abuses and the legal system?
You mean when I was inside Iran, you know, this movement that I was talking about, that the movement for getting better interpretation of Islam, we were following that. We were following this movement because reform was according this idea. And that's why we could talk and we could be alive. Because we were not talking about something against Islam. But sometimes they said, when you criticize Islamic penal code, when you criticize stoning, when you criticize lashing or something like that, it means that you are working against Islam. And when I was in prison, they were talking something like that to me. And I could understand that they have a lot of documents about me. And all documents were criticizing of legal system against women's rights or something. But they said, we don't mind about that. Just we can accuse you like somebody who is working against Islam. This is the mind and the opinion of fundamentalists in Iran. But some other Muslim people who are working in Iran for that movement, even now, they say, no, you can criticize Islamic law, and it doesn't mean you are working against Islam. So all years after, even after revolution, especially after 1997, these two views were clash with each other. And some part they said, okay, Mrs. Kar is right, she can criticize, and somebody, no, we can stop her. And this is something that now is inside the inside government, but judiciary system, the base of judiciary system is fundamentalist and traditional Islam. Let's say anybody who talks against legal system or against the Velayat-e Faqih, supreme leader, or something like that, they have to be punished.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and I'm sorry if I couldn't explain something, but my English is not perfect. Thank you very much. Thanks so much for having me. Thank you. Thank you. I could explain something.